Well, joining us to talk about it, intellectual property attorney Etienne Droit. Good evening. Welcome back, sir. Is it a hornet's nest, as Nicholas Rushworth described in that report?
It's true that we may have different visions on freedom of speech, but the limits exist in any democracy, in fact. And then now, because of the situation, we will have tensions on this freedom of speech debate, because we may prevent a free speech. We may also react quickly when people do support any terrorism action. And because this new legislation was adopted in November 2014 in order to sanction any apology for crimes and terrorism, we are in a new situation where you could prosecute someone for a tweet, which was not possible in the same way before. And it is just coming in the same time with these terrorist attacks.
And on that point, the Justice Ministry saying 54 people, including underage people, minors, have already been convicted under special measures for immediate sentencing, and this for inciting terrorism. What's your reaction to that?
It's the beginning. The two first days after the attacks, we had 3,170 tweets with such reactions from people. Some could be just provocations. The other ones were more serious. The first condemnation are about 1 year imprisonment, and we will have some others. It shows also that the reaction is very...
Is that justified? 1 year behind bars?
For those concerned, I think yes, because these people were not only saying a sentence, but they were also insisting on it. Not all of them were distributed through the internet. Some of them were with policemen or in a bus, etc. But these convictions were, I think, appropriate because these people were really turning bad.
1 year, though, behind bars. One young man in Nice yells at police, "I'm 100% Kouachi." Kouachi, those two brothers who perpetrated the Charlie Hebdo attacks. It surprises people in Anglo-Saxon countries to see these kinds of sentences.
Yes, I do understand this as a surprise. I'm also a bit uncomfortable when I see... Anglo-Saxon newspaper, we don't want to publish Charlie Hebdo news or cover because they don't have the same approach or culture of any debate relating to religion. So it's true that we don't have the same culture, we may face the same risks, but we don't have the same answers. So the period is in trouble, and I do understand the search of price.
To each his own taboos. Now, on this issue of getting the major tech firms to collaborate with the government in internet surveillance. Is that going to work?
It's going to work with willingness, cooperation. I'm not sure it will work because France would adopt...
Do you see Facebook and Google agreeing to do this?
They do collaborate. They will never say that they do agree because there is a lack of legal ground for some warrants or subpoenas launched by French authorities. So I'm not sure that will be more efficient if we first adopt a law pushing them to answer to French authorities. Maybe national security cooperation between states is the good way to have their cooperation instead of sanctions based on French law when these companies are based in California, in fact.
After the Snowden revelations on cyber snooping on the part of government agencies, after the cases we've seen here in Europe, the right to be forgotten cases, which some of which I know you worked on, involving Google and the right to be forgotten by some people. Is it a bit of a paradox now to get people to agree in this case to get those big tech corporations to agree to help?
They may be useful for law enforcement services for in different dimensions, I would say. Some institutions, administrations would fight against Google or Facebook for commercial use of personal data and privacy issues relating to your life as a consumer. But now we do understand that they also are a center for mass communication, which is necessary for these national security
purposes. So how do you do that? On the one hand, you've got to help us when it's involving national security, but please don't look at the data
when
for
it's
your
for
own commercial
purposes
if you want to target, say, advertisers.
That's perfectly the situation. Yeah.
Can you do it? Is it possible?
To have dual speech in this situation, yes, because the purposes are not the same. Because also it's a matter of economic warfare versus national security and international cooperation for terrorism fight.
And do you do it through, say, court-ordered subpoenas? Do you have a framework? Is there the legal framework? Does it already exist for monitoring these groups?
There is a hole in the international cooperation. There is Interpol, criminal prosecution cooperation. However, when you ask for information in real time, you will not go through a diplomatic route or judicial route. When you need an answer from a private sector's company that has the information of the identification of a terrorist or of someone. And for that, I would say cooperation between police services works better than legal grounds coming from French law against a Californian company. So it's true that today this debate on a French Patriot Act is a kind of mistake, at least on the vocabulary, because these companies are not French. So we have to work differently than with the Patriot Act in the US imposed or applicable to any US company.
So how do you preserve people's civil liberties while doing a better job of policing the internet?
Put a judge in the control of the decision, and not only administration and national security services. It's not a matter of trust, it's a matter of balance of power. And we should do that because it was maybe a mistake in the Patriot Act. We should not replicate that. This is why we should not use this French Patriot Act initiative now. And also, if it's not a judge, it could be an independent administrative body. We have two of them in France. One is in charge of wiretapping for national security purposes, and they are therefore controlling administrations and law enforcement services. The other one is the French Privacy Authority. They could have also a power in investigating technical tools used and the way you can filter or identify a population of people who were at risk or who could create risks. These are technical tools behind, and these administrations could be the right independent body for control, but the administration alone, even if the purpose is legitimate, would not work in a democracy. So I try to convince people now, especially at the French Parliament, that the purpose is not an issue. We all agree on the purpose, but the means and balance of powers is something which would reflect the state of our democracy.
And do you see that happening? Do you see there being more means, more? Because people are saying, some people are arguing that you already have a lot of laws and you have a lot of tools and you have a lot of technical equipment for
exactly.
for monitoring. What you're missing is humans to actually man this equipment, and like you were saying, judges. And is it a question of manpower or is it a question of laws?
It's a question of manpower, definitely. We had three reforms in the last 14 months on military services, anti-terrorism framework, electronic surveillance. Decrees were not adopted, and we were still missing some text that maybe will be adopted because of these events. However, before these attacks, any debate on balance of power was just forgotten by the parliament. So I'm afraid that today they will still forget it. So I'm not very optimistic on this balance situation. And there is no doubt on the power, but maybe the balance will be the key point.
Etienne Drouin arguing you can do a better job of policing the internet while at the same time keeping a balance of power between various branches of government. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you.
Here on France 24. Stay with us. There's much more to come.